following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
When Nicole Sandler sits down to do her show, she's the producer, booking the guests, pulling the audio, planning the show, the engineer, running the controls, troubleshooting any problems, playing the sounds, calling the guests, and she's the webmaster, writing the blog, posting the podcast, maintaining the website, not to mention the host, interviewing the guests, explaining the issues, giving opinions, and calling out the bad guys, and then you get the Nicole Sandler Show on NicoleSandler.com.
And with that, we're on. Welcome to a Monday. It's a brand new week. Oh, yeah, and the week got off to a very, very weird start. It begins with early this morning, breaking news at 8 a.m., Colin Powell died. Died of complications from COVID. But that's not the whole story. See, then they went on to say, and Colin Powell was fully vaccinated. Yes, he was. What they didn't tell you right off the bat is that he was very sick. Colin Powell had multiple myeloma. He was immunocompromised. He had cancer. The people who are immunocompromised don't necessarily produce the antibodies from the vaccine. This is why it's so important for everyone else to wear a mask. What don't you get? And of course, the foxies, the flat earthers among us, they started, even somebody, you know, Fox people were like, see, that just shows you've got to question the efficacy of the vaccines. And they wound up deleting those tweets. You know, just stop it. Please, just stop it. So that happened. And then just moments ago, 15 minutes ago, I got the breaking news alert. Donald Trump is suing the January 6th Select Committee and the National Archives to block the release of his White House records related to the Capitol attack. Oh, my God. The former guy's lawyers filed the suit in D.C. District Court today. It names the January 6th panel's chair, Representative Benny Thompson, and the National Archivist, whose name is David Ferrero, along with the committee and the archives. And it calls the January 6th probe a, quote, vexatious illegal fishing expedition. All right, good luck with that. I'm not even going to go there because we've got bigger, better things to talk about today. Now, we have an interview coming up in just a moment with Anita Hill. I was so excited about this one, and for good reason. I mean, Anita Hill changed the world. She is the first person to ever speak in such a forum about gender violence, sexual harassment, all that stuff. It was 1991 when she testified before the Senate Judiciary Committee at Clarence Thomas's confirmation hearing when he was named to the Supreme Court. I know, look, 1991, this, and it was October 11th, so it was 30 years and a week ago. Exactly. And I know a lot of people maybe didn't get to hear that testimony, so I thought I'd share a little bit of it with you. So, I'm going to show you a video here, and this video is, this video is a piece edited together by CNN. There are a number of similar videos like it out there. And basically what it does is it purports to edit together some of the most offensive questions asked of Ms. Hill. A professor? I don't think she was professor then. She's professor now. I don't know that she was professor then. Hold on one second. Let me see. All right. So let me share this with you to just give you an idea. When we talk about how offensive the questioning of her was, this is what we're talking about. So let's start with this. Here we go. A few of the questions.
What was the most embarrassing?
Joe Biden.
Of all the incidences that you have alleged?
The incident involved his going to his desk getting up from a work table, going to his desk, looking at this can and saying, "Who put pubic hair on my Coke?" Oi.
She was questioned by an all-white, all-male committee.
He said to me, very casually, "You ought to go out with me sometime."
You ought to, or you are to?
You ought to.
That was Biden's question.
Testified this morning in response to Senator Biden that the most embarrassing question involved, this is not too bad, women's large breasts. That's the word we use all
that's
the time.
That's Arlen Specter.
Are you a scorned
not
woman?
Too bad, my ass.
Oy. You referred to the, quote, oddest episode I remember, and then talked about the Coke incident. When you made your statement to the FBI, why was it that that was omitted if it was so strong in your mind and such an odd incident?
I suppose every member of this committee have to come down to the ultimate question of who's telling the truth.
All we've heard for 103 days is about a most remarkable man, and nobody has come forward, and they scoured his every shred of life, and nobody but you and another witness, apparently, who's alleging no sexual harassment, has come forward.
What is your view of the fairness of asking Judge Thomas to reply 8, 9, 10 years after the fact?
I don't believe it's unfair. I think that that's something that you have to take into account in evaluating his comments.
Maybe. It seems to me you didn't really intend to kill him.
Oh, fuck you.
But
that's
you might
Alan
have.
Simpson. Alan Simpson? Really? So you got the gist of it, right? They were rude. They questioned her truthfulness, her veracity. They basically called her a liar. It was so upsetting. But Anita Hill, as Jan Morgan said in the chat room, she was a brave woman. She still is. So they questioned her honesty. So it's for good reason that her book is called Believing. Anita Hill, Believing, Our 30-Year Journey to End Gender Violence. Again, we had to tape this earlier today. We taped it. It was around noon my time. It's now 5. I got to tell you, she was so gracious. First of all, I was late. I wrote in my book 12 to 12:30, but all I saw was the 12:30. And so my phone started ringing around, I don't know, 10 after 12. And I recognized the number. It's like, oh my God, it's her. And so I screwed up. But she was so gracious and so wonderful. And as you'll hear, she stayed on with me almost till the top of the hour. So we went longer than the 30 minutes we had allotted and could have kept going. I am so honored to be speaking with Anita Hill right now. Anita Hill, of course, a lawyer, a professor, author. Her new book is just out. It's called Believing, Our 30-Year Journey to End Gender Violence. I'm holding up my copy to the camera, and it's got a lot of post-it notes scattered throughout because I've been flagging things as I go along. The book is just fascinating. It's very hard to put down, and it transports us, at least for part of it, back 30 years to 1991, when you testified before the Senate Judiciary Committee at Clarence Thomas's Supreme Court confirmation hearing. To my knowledge, I think you were the first woman to actually speak out publicly in such a manner about gender violence or sex discrimination. Were you the first?
Well, at least on the national level, I think I was the first to speak in front of a, national U.S. Panel or committee. There had been, in fact, some hearings in the state of New York that were organized around this issue of sexual harassment in the workplace. That was even before there was a name for it. It was back in the 70s, and Eleanor Holmes Norton was one of the people behind organizing those. But in terms of the kind of coverage that the 1991 hearings from Clarence Thomas got, I think That it was a singular event, and as I've come to understand it, it was a pivotal event in terms of the public conversation and understanding of the issues.
Without a doubt. Obviously, you bring something that has been had been talked about really kind of in hushed tones, and you put it on for all to see, and all did see. 1991 seems like so long ago, but it was really just the blink of an eye. And, you know, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Fast forward to 2018 and Dr. Christine Blasey Ford testifying at Brett Kavanaugh's Senate Supreme Court confirmation hearings. Did you feel the same butterflies in your stomach when you were watching her? Did you get the same? I'm just guessing that you had these visceral reactions, I can only imagine, but did it take you back to that moment?
I think, in fact, that there's probably a greater sense of dread that in 2018 because I had experienced how things could go very badly. Not only were there indications before her testimony that things were going to go badly, and they did. There was no process, no place for her to go to file her complaint. She gave her complaint to Senator Feinstein, and then she was criticized, or Feinstein was criticized for taking it. And but there was a sense of dread about how the process would go. And then finally, what would happen to her afterwards? Because those are all the things that I had gone through. And I knew that unless that there was a real change in terms of the thinking of the Senate leadership, in 2018, it was Chairman Grassley. But Grassley had been on the committee in 1991 as well.
Wow.
And so I knew that there was a slim chance that she might be able to get a fair process, but that the odds were that she wouldn't, and that people would, how people would respond to the outcome, it wasn't clear either.
Right, right. But obviously attitudes have changed over the last 30 years. In 2018, I'm trying to remember and put myself back there. The Me Too movement had already begun, right? People started talking about, women started talking about, not only women, others have been sexually harassed as well, but it's mostly women, I think, had been talking about it, and there were some consequences already happening. But did you expect any kind of a different outcome, or did you know deep down that she was going to get the same kind of treatment you had?
You know, I'm ever hopeful that outcomes can change, that people can see and really understand. I mean, that these are serious charges, and that when particularly they're important when we're talking about people who are in a position or consideration to be on the highest court in the country for a lifetime appointment, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, of course, I was hopeful because I have seen the change. I know that, in fact, we are more knowledgeable about the behavior. Me Too had just happened the year before, and mm-hmm. I know what kind of reckoning that we expected from Me Too, and really a sense of where people really did, for the first time, see that this is a real problem, it's a pervasive problem, and the whole range of behaviors and how they've infiltrated just about every institution that we have make it clear that it's a problem that's not going to go away. It's pervasive, it's built into our systems and supported by our culture, and that we need to begin to address it. That was the part that made me hopeful, this new awareness. But that was balanced against the traditions of the Senate Judiciary Committee, the willingness for politicians to really challenge, politicians of the same party to challenge a sitting president who really had control of the whole process.
Right. We're speaking with Anita Hill, and the book, again, is Believing, Our 30-Year Journey to End Gender Violence. Believing, the title, one could take it in different ways. Is it a directive, or is it identifying the problem, or is it something else?
Well, it for me came from hearing from over the past 30 years now of thousands of stories, hearing thousands of stories, victims and survivors from all walks of life, all races, all genders, and really believing myself that they deserve better, mm-hmm. that we all deserve better. Not just, you know, we talk about the Senate Judiciary Committee, but the Senate Judiciary Committee's process and treatment was really a reflection of what many of us face when we raise complaints about sexual or other forms of gender violence. And so that is, I have spent my past 30 years or so believing that we deserve better, that our families deserve better, our colleagues who try to support us deserve better, that our institutions deserve better, and that we can do better, that as a country we can do better. And part of that comes from the gains that we have made in the public, but also a realization that we haven't gone far enough. You know, you said earlier, I think something like the more we learn, the more we realize how much we have to learn. Yeah. And I think that's exactly where we are. It's like once you begin awareness, you realize how huge the problem is, that it doesn't begin in the workplace. It doesn't begin among adults. It really even begins in our schools. Our elementary, middle, and high school.
Sure.
And so we've got a lot of work to do. We've made some gains, but we're not there yet.
You know,
and there are some things we can do, and I believe in those things.
Like what? What? Or should we save that for the end? Because there's got to be solutions, and I know this is your goal in writing this book. In fact, you lay them out in the introduction. What are your goals for the book?
Well, I want the voices of survivors and victims to be heard. I want them to be centered in this conversation. Very often, when we hear conversations about allegations that are raised, they almost always begin with, well, how is this going to hurt the career of the powerful person who is being accused?
Wow.
And that so often that's where the conversation starts. And I want the conversation about this problem to start with the survivors and the victim. That's where I want it to start. And how can we address them? So I want us to change the way we talk. I want us to stop telling, you know, school children, girls, for example, when they've been harassed or bullied or teased as they're reaching adolescents about their bodies, whether they're classmates or men, grown men on the street, as that often happens, that stop telling them that behavior's not so bad, or
right.
That's just what boys do, or that's what men do. And so they have to tolerate it. I want us to stop denying the existence of this problem. We've had high place commentary that basically says, you know, that, well, it's not a major problem, or women are still making up these stories to get ahead or for some political or social advantage. Around victimhood. And I want, then finally, I want us to stop denying it. And there is a form of denial that happens when we blame victims. Intimate partner violence is one of those areas where we blame women who are in abusive relationships because we, you know, say things, well, why doesn't she just, if she would just leave,
right,
things would be fine. And so we have to address the culture, but I also want people not only to change their own way of thinking and talking about this problem and quit accepting those denials and dismissive excuses. I want them to challenge our leaders, because one thing we know about change, organizational change, is that it starts at the top. And if we have leaders who acknowledge the problem and commit and put resources into making solutions a priority, then we can move people. And that can be our role, instead of placing all of that burden on victims who have already been the subjects of abuse.
Right.
So then we can start to work on the systems, systems and structures that are holding our progress back.
Right. You know, there are so many different directions I can go. Just listening to you, it brings up a lot of different questions. But I got to ask if you've either read the book or seen the new Netflix series called Made, because this is what you're writing about. In fact, I binged it. I think it's 10 episodes. And it's a story written by a woman named Stephanie Land. And she was a young mother who wound up leaving her abusive husband. And she embodies exactly the story you're telling. And I binged it a couple of weeks ago, and then I started reading your book, and I had this light bulb moment. It's like, oh my God, these two go together. It's pretty, if you haven't checked it out yet, you should, because this is your story, what you're fighting against brought to life. This woman, people don't believe her. And why didn't she just leave? And the husband, or the father of her daughter, wasn't physically abusive, didn't hit her, but he was abusive. And it shows that there are so many different levels of gender-based violence.
Yes, and I wish I had had the benefit of the program when I was writing this book, because I try to use examples from pop culture, but I also try to use real stories of people to really make the point, because sometimes you have to have examples, because you can tell people and they don't quite get it until they see it acted out. So I'm thankful for those very few, relatively few stories that actually do portray the problem clearly,
yes,
and accurately. You know, but to your other point is that, you know, there are questions about when I talk about harassment and bullying and then I've put this into the bigger category of gender violence along with sexual assault, and rape and intimate partner violence. And in the case, really, I talk about some partners who have been killed, women who have been killed by their partners. You know, people say, well, how can you put all of that stuff together? And I think it's exactly what you point out. We have this very narrow definition of violence. And maybe the better word is narrow definition of what it means to be violated. And it doesn't often include the emotional violence. And I think that's another area that we need to grow in. When a person is on a job and they're being harassed, or there are attempts to extort them for sex, there's no physical violence, but there is an emotional violence and assault. And a sense of intimidation, that they could lose their job, they could lose their livelihood, because they are not complying with the wishes of a more powerful individual. And they know how that not only can hurt with that particular job, but with other jobs in the future. And the same with a situation where somebody is being abused by their partner, you know, people will definitely try to excuse emotional violence. Well, maybe I just had a bad day, or maybe there was something that you said that set him off. And we don't take into account that all over the globe, one, they're starting to acknowledge these different types of violence or violations. And two, that it's really time for us to think about what safety means to its fullest extent, that what we are trying to do is to make sure that people have their own agency and their own authority. They are not in a relationship where they're manipulated or abused, whether it's physical or emotional or psychological or economic.
Mm-hmm. And it's all of those. All of those fall under that heading of abuse.
Absolutely. And, right. But we don't quite all understand that. I mean, that's one of the levels of awareness that we haven't quite grasped because we've been taught and programmed to think if there is abuse, that there are going to be bruises and
right.
marks. And that is very often not the case.
No. And, you know, knowing that I was going to be speaking with you today, I went back and watched some of your testimony before the Senate Judiciary Committee at Clarence Thomas's confirmation hearing. I watched your opening statement, which was brilliant and courageous. And then I watched some of the questioning. There are a number of montages put together by various news outlets about the most offensive questioning you got. A little while ago, you referred to something like, oh, it's not so bad. Well, Arlen Specter used that line on you a few times, discussing things that really were bad. Did you feel that you were being assaulted in that moment again, like the way you were treated by this panel of white men, and that's all that was on that panel who were questioning you?
Well, I just felt like either he was deliberately trying to reduce me and my significance, or he was just oblivious to what women go through. Either way, it didn't matter. It was entirely offensive. And again, a way that we re-traumatize people when they tell us their stories.
Right.
That, in fact, it is the second assault. And then there's one other thing that really, and sort of in the universal interpretation of what was going on, and that is that he dared to assert his authority over my experience and how it felt.
Uh-huh.
And that he could define what was good or bad for me, that I had no right to define it for myself. And that, I think, is the part that is really hurting us, is that we don't give women, especially women as victims, the right to have authority over their own experiences, to be an authority on their own experiences. We allow powerful men to take control of that and define what is good or bad for us. And that's part of the cultural problem that we have. What it leads then to is that in case of accusations against powerful people, then men's words are taken. One of the most perverse examples of that is the situation involving Larry Nassar, who was abusing children for decades, who was reported to the FBI by the Olympic gymnast who spoke last month to Congress about their experience with this FBI agent, who they told they were being abused. And according to one of the gymnasts, the agent seemed entirely indifferent upon hearing how, as a 13-year-old, Larry Nassar had assaulted her, who then, the agent, took the statement and did nothing with it in any respect, didn't follow up, didn't investigate.
Right.
And what happened after that was Larry Nassar was able to abuse as many as 70 to 100 others. So this is why this tendency to substitute a male, a powerful male perspective for the perspective of victims is so dangerous. It not only hurts the people who are reporting, but it sets up the abuser for continued abuse, and in this case, multiple abuses.
But it even gets worse, because after those four of these gymnasts testified before the Senate, not even a month ago, maybe, and they talked about these FBI agents and their coldness and the lack of follow-through, we find out that nothing is going to be done to these FBI agents who did nothing to protect these young girls, to these young women. Nothing. That their behavior was just allowed to go. I found that appalling.
Well, absolutely. And that is sort of the next step. Not only is the definition of what is abuse defined in their terms, that gets built into the processes. Their judgment, their decisions get built into the process, and they're allowed the discretion to abandon claims, abandon these victims without any repercussions. Now, I do understand from a report that I saw recently that they are reconsidering whether to bring charges against these two agents that really just completely spectacularly failed everyone, not only the women who testified, but those who came afterwards. But I don't know what that process is. I don't know what their standards are for holding those people accountable for that failure. And that's when I say, you know, our structures then get the bias against victims built into them. And then you end up with these horrific outcomes and seemingly no recourse.
Right.
But I'm hopeful that something will be done. And if it doesn't involve these agents, that the rules get changed so that if this ever does happen again, that people are on notice that they will be held accountable.
Oh, yes. Well, there's got to be consequences for this behavior. Anita Hill is our guest, and I'm so honored to have you here. And I've got a million questions for you, and I hope you don't mind. I want to go back for a moment to the 1991 testimony and Joe Biden, who is now president of the United States. I thought his treatment of you was reprehensible, as it was for pretty much everyone on that panel. And even in the little snippets that I watched this morning, you see him publicly doubting your veracity, calling into question, you know, if you're telling the truth or not. In the book, you get to the end, near the end of the book, around page 285, and you talk about in the election, toward the end of the election, Joe Biden is already the nominee. And a woman named Tara Reid comes forth with charges of pretty horrible sexual harassment, sexual abuse charges against Joe Biden. You say you say that her case, that there should have been an investigation there, as there should have been of Brett Kavanaugh after the allegations raised by Christine Blasey Ford. This is still a big problem we have, where women's allegations are not taken seriously. In both these cases, you think there should have been full investigations?
Absolutely. I mean, I said so at the time when Tara Reid came forward. I said, we've got to have a way to investigate this problem. Not only is this to benefit Tara Reid, out of respect for her coming forward to raise these complaints, but also, you know, for the public. You know, we're talking about people who are public figures, who are making decisions about all of us, who are representing our government, and representing all of the people in it. We public deserves more. They need to have an understanding of the truth. Now, I've do since then think that in terms of we have an example now for a how we can begin those processes with the investigation into Andrew Cuomo and the charges that were brought against him, that we had an attorney general who went through the process and interviewed the witnesses, did an investigation. If you read, there's a long report as to how they went about it. She was very clear about where she landed in terms of evidence that she found from both sides were allowed to testify. Came up with a conclusion. There was an outcome. I don't think that she dictated the outcome. Cuomo initially held out, but then went on to resign. So there was an outcome. There was a sense of accountability. There was an understanding of the public how decisions were reached. And I think the public was better served. I think it cut back on a whole lot of the conversation about, well, we don't really have the evidence, or, you know, is this the he said, she said.
Right.
I mean, there was a record provided. There's a reason that we need to have these processes in place, because the public deserves to know. Individuals who have complaints deserve to know how they're going to be treated. And you know, we all benefit when it's done well. It doesn't mean that there's not going to be accountability, or that, you know, the outcome is going to be that the governor or the public person resigns. We don't know what the outcomes will be, but we do know that we deserve at least a process that allows for truth finding.
Yes. Oh, without a doubt. Now, with Joe Biden, I know that he famously, finally, after a big fanfare, apologized to you, where you say, you know, he could have just picked up the phone and done it rather than have this whole orchestrated dance in place. Were you satisfied with his apology? Do you think he knows what they did wrong? Do you think he's changed in attitude over the years?
Well, in terms of the apology, it was limited. It was limited to an apology for his management or mismanagement of the hearing process.
Mm-hmm.
Personal apology to me. That's one part of the problem. The harm that was done to me during the hearing, the way the questioning unfolded, and as you remarked, the indications in the way the things that were said, indications that I was not being truthful.
Right.
And some of came come from other people without any challenges. The fact that he didn't call witnesses to corroborate, I mean, that's an apology for the process. There was no apology that fit the entire harm. The entire harm of that process didn't begin or end with me.
No.
It ended with, you know, with people all over the country losing confidence and trust in our processes. It ended in victims who might have had claims not coming forward because they realized that the process was either going to eat them up or it wasn't going to take them seriously when they stepped up. I mean, it ended with people believing that we have on the Supreme Court and now two justices that do not belong there.
Yeah.
And as I've said in describing the Cuomo process, much of that could have been alleviated had there been a better, fairer process that took the claim seriously and had a way for them to be heard and evaluated outside the political decision of who was going to be on the Supreme Court, or in the case of Joe Biden, who should be sitting in the White House.
Yeah, when you look at who was in the White House, For instance, when Christine Blasey Ford testified, I felt like I was through the looking glass. That is a whole other thing. We had a president who was a serial sexual harasser, sexual assaulter. And there are charges out there that hopefully he will have to answer to. But then I go back to Christine Blasey Ford, who was also treated horrendously. And I know you felt nervous for her. You had the sense of dread. You've spoken with her since. How is she doing? Do we know?
And she and I spoke on a podcast. It wasn't the first time that I've been in touch with her, but it was the first time that I was able to sit down and have a real conversation. You know, in that conversation, I was really talking to her as someone who had gone through an experience much like what she'd gone through, not only the confusion and chaos before and during the hearing, the Kavanaugh hearing, that matched mine as well during the Thomas hearing, but also for the horrific behavior that got piled onto her and her family afterwards.
Yeah.
And that, you know, that was really what the conversation was about, is how it was about, how are you doing? And really an assurance that things would get better. I believe she has started to work through what happened. It's not easy. It takes time. But I think some of the vitriol could have been eliminated had our leader stepped up and defended her right to come forward as strongly as they had defended Brett Kavanaugh.
Right. Yeah, well, that obviously didn't happen. And Brett Kavanaugh sitting on the Supreme Court.
And certainly the president
would never do that. No, in fact, we've seen what he does, and he'll attack, you know, the victim. That's his MO. It's astounding and sickening. So that brings us to the question that I sort of put off at the beginning.
I mean,
the former guy.
The former President Trump.
Yes, exactly, the former guy. So, Professor Hill, what do we do? How do we address the epidemic, the pandemic of gender-based violence, because it is in every aspect of our society. Try as we might to say, oh, we've evolved. In many cases, we haven't. So how do we respond? What do we do from here? And how are you addressing this? I know this has become your focus right now.
Well, and to that point, you know, I wanted to say, President Biden, when I spoke, and he talked about Violence Against Women Act, which he supported, and he talked about the campus sexual assault campaign against campus sexual assault that he was very much engaged in. He talked about his own evolution, and yet the problem exists.
Right.
And yet the problem exists, and seemingly endlessly throughout our different institutions. So, first of all, we've got to acknowledge, and it includes the president, includes all of us, that we haven't gone far enough because the problem still exists.
Right.
So we haven't gone far enough. Admit that this problem is deep and it's complex, and it is going to take changes in our own behavior, like I had described earlier about how we talk to and talk about victims and survivors. It's going to take changes in our systems, the policies and practices. I mean, we talked about non-disclosure agreements and forced arbitration of these claims that really leave institutions pretty much in the same place and victims who bring claims dissatisfied in many cases. Those are just two minor things. I'm talking about entire structural change that needs to take place. And that requires our leaders to act. It requires our leaders to act, but we've got to push them.
Yes.
we've got to push them. And when we're talking, to candidates who are going to lead the country, we need to make sure that they have prioritized this issue. We need to make it part of campaign conversations, whether we're media people or citizens who stand up in a town hall and ask questions. We've got to be more proactive. But ultimately, it is up to our leaders, our president of the United States, the president of our large corporations, the presidents, the CEOs who are operating them, the heads of our military, adjusting now to the new rules that are being put forward to eliminate the problem there. They are the ones who have the power to make things change. Even down to the principals of our schools, principals and school superintendents in school districts, they have the power to change what is going on in their institutions. And we've got to have policing that understands this issue and addresses this. You know, the abysmal rate of the number of sexual assault and rapes that actually go to a DA and
it's so low.
Ultimately gets heard by a jury. It's just abysmally low. I mean, it's stunning. And no other crime that I know of has such a low rate of prosecution as sexual assault and rape. We need to address that. And if police forces don't address it, then our Justice Department needs to address it. So first of all, we got to acknowledge that we have a pervasive problem. It's cultural, that's endemic, and that it's not going to go away on its own unless we take aggressive measures. We secondly have to prioritize them. And then where I start at the beginning is that we have to put survivors and victims in the process, look to them for their guidance and their solutions, because they do understand this in a way that needs to be put into the solutions that we come up with. I know that's just sort of at the high level. Are there some specific things we can do? The federal government, the president can, in looking with and assessing and gathering information, we need more data. We can call upon every cabinet agency to address specifically within their agency, one, how they are going to help victims directly, and two, what are the processes within their agencies and in the institutions that they have control over, whether we're talking about housing, whether we're talking about labor, where are the processes? What are they that are holding us back from eliminating this problem? So there's a lot that can be done. I mean, it's a lot of heavy lifting. This is like boiling the ocean,
right?
Because it is so complicated. But if we say that it's too big for our government to fix, then we have to really address whether we have the right government.
Well, in many cases, we don't. And if the last 4 years set us back enormously, I mean, just look at Betsy DeVos as Secretary of Education and what she did about the problems of sexual assault on campus. I mean, the fact that there's enough of people in this country who will vote for that is astounding and depressing. We need to get past that.
We do. And I think one of the things that is popular now when we talk about how we're going to do that, especially around colleges, is the question about due process. We do have due process protections in our systems. But what that typically, what people don't understand, is that having due process doesn't mean that you get to silence people, that you prevent people from talking about what has happened to them, about their own personal experiences. We do need to protect the rights of the people who are being accused. You know, as a lawyer, you know, and as a person of African American, an African American, a person of African descent, I know how unfair the law has been to people and in denying due process. I would never advocate for a system that neglected due process for everyone. But what we also have to understand is that we are, at this point, have systems, and some of those were put in place under DeVos, where the balance has tipped the other way, mm-hmm. that all of the protections seem to be going in the direction of, again, covering for bad behavior,
yeah.
and few of the consequences for engaging in that bad behavior continue to apply. And so where is the balance? We have hard, we've got a lot of work to do. We do, I respect due process as well, but due process can't mean what we have seen in terms of even the prosecution of rape cases, where, again, this low rate of going forward and representing the people's best interest in criminal cases by pursuing the claims that come in and taking people who are often serial rapists off the streets.
I hear you. Things need to change. Your voice will certainly help that, Anita Hill. I speak for every woman I know in thanking you for your courage coming forward 30 years ago and for continuing the fight. I know the book is out. It's called Believing, Our 30-Year Journey to End Gender Violence. I can't recommend it highly enough. And you've got a podcast coming.
I do. I'm looking forward to it. We're going to explore many of these issues that are raised in Believing. We're going to talk a little bit about my life, because I think people still think I was born in 1991 and,
right.
and then I disappeared from the face of the earth. I came back in 2021. But so I want to, again, I want to humanize myself as I'm trying to humanize many of the victims and survivors. But it is also very clearly a podcast that's dedicated to solving problems, to getting to a real sense of equity in society. And I get to talk to people who are moving us in that direction in big and dynamic ways.
Wonderful. And this is going to start in 2022?
2022 will be the launch.
Terrific. Well, I'll make sure, hopefully you'll keep me informed, and I will make sure the listeners know. This has been such an honor and a pleasure for me. Anita Hill, I could keep talking for hours, but I know you've got other things to do. I can't thank you enough.
I am so grateful for the time you've given me. And thank you for all of your work in these podcasts. They really are powerful.
Thank you so very much. Anita Hill, how amazingly special was that? As I said earlier, first of all, I was late. I had the time wrong in my book. And so she called, and I heard the phone ringing, and I finally got back to her, and she was so gracious. And then not only did she stay on with me for the 30 minutes we had scheduled, but for an extra 15 minutes or so, and we could have kept going. She was that wonderful. And we talked a little bit off the air, and she's like, oh, maybe you can help me with my podcast. It's like, anytime, please, I'll give you my number and all my stuff and feel free to call. Just how wonderful is she? And here's the thing. She's a private person. She didn't expect any of this. You read the book and you'll get a lot of insight into her. She thought she was going to go testify, and then she was just going to go home and live her life. And everything changed. The way she was treated by those men, and yes, they were all men, all white men. 1991 doesn't seem that long ago, but it also seems like eons ago, ages ago, because so much has changed. And yet, as I said, so much has stayed the same. We've had improvement in some areas, but boy, not nearly enough. We should have grown by leaps and bounds. We shouldn't still be talking about the same things. And the misogyny and the ugliness that she experienced when she testified in a Supreme Court confirmation hearing should have been in the history books by 2018, when Christine Blasey Ford had basically the same experience. So I never heard the podcast they did together, but I was looking online for information about Anita Hill's forthcoming podcast, and what comes up is the program she did with Christine Blasey Ford. I know what I'm going to put on my, you know, to listen to list, because I'm sure that's pretty amazing. She said, you know, she's been teaching law. She's been a professor. She teaches at Brandeis. But she even said, and she didn't quite state it when I asked her, but her goal for the book, she said, the enormity of gender-based violence is only one reason for its broad impact. Society's reaction to gender-based violence also makes it a tangled morass of a problem to solve. We respond to obvious and ubiquitous abuses by pretending they don't exist. Outright denial is only one response. Minimizing the problem through the language we use to describe abuses and their impact is just as widespread as our denials. We favor piecemeal solutions directed at intimations of gender-based violence, like telling women not to drink to excess or dress in sexually suggestive clothing, so we can ignore the many cultural and societal factors that suborn it and the way it inhabits our systems. And the ocean of gender-based offenses continues to grow and get passed on from generation to generation. Because the impact of abuse varies over time and from individual to individual, I use the term victims and survivors to talk about the people who've experienced gender violence. And she says, my goals for this book are as enormous as the problem itself. The issue, the problem, is nothing short of a national crisis. And in seeking to change the way we think and talk about gender violence, I run the risk of biting off more than I can chew. But my goal only matches the size of the crisis. And actually changing what we do about gender-based violence, and I'm sure to be labeled as too ambitious, the bane of working women, no matter their job or occupation, I'm willing to take that risk. And so here she is at the end of her, you know, this career. She's going full on into doing something about gender-based violence. And as we discussed, it's all violence, whether there's physical abuse involved or not. I was so energized by that interview. I love her. I think she's a hero. And that's why I thanked her on behalf of all the women I know, all the people I know, seriously. All right. So the book is there. It's available. Read it. I'm going to hold on to this copy. Usually I offer the books for a donation to the show, but this one I'm going to keep because. All right. With that, we're done for the day. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. Feel free to share it. It will be posted momentarily at NicoleSandler.com/10-18-21. That's today's date. That's how I post the shows. I think everybody needs to hear that. And with that, we're done.